with everyone. Please stand as we sing our call to worship. Come, now is the time to worship.
Let us pray. Our gracious and heavenly Father, how awesome, how everlasting, how great you are. We thank you so very much, Lord, for this day that you set aside for us to come and to worship you. Praise, honor, and glory be to you, O Father. May we give you our praise, and we ask your blessing on this service. And we ask it all in your Son's holy and precious name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen.
I'm going to read from Psalms chapter 118, verse 28 through 29. You are my God, and I will praise you. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Please sing with me soon and very soon on page 757.
Thank you. Well, good Sabbath, everyone. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Well, let's go through the announcements here. of course, today we see the announcement for the men's and ladies' studies. That will continue at least through the middle of July. So ladies will continue with the Gideon study. The men is going to be potluck. And we came up with a theme of if you could say something to the men of the church, what would you say, or what would God have you say to the men? So each guy in the group is going to do a study, so and lead a study and see what God wants to say through that person. So next week it'll be Mr. Watlington will be the leader, and we'll go from there. We'll see who will be next after that. June 9th is the scheduled Springvale Sound Concert. We have the opportunity, and that's something we need to decide today. We can have that concert on the following Sunday, and I think it's the 14th, if we prefer. And I think that might be better because people that travel from some distance, it's easier to get here on a Sunday than it would be on a Tuesday night. So we could plan the concert for maybe 6 o'clock Sunday evening. You could just raise your hand if you would prefer that over the Tuesday night, if you would raise your hand on June the 14th. And might make it more available for people to be able to make it. So looks like most people were in favor of that. Is anybody really opposed to that? Or then let's go ahead and I will tell them that we're going to switch it to June the 14th then, and we'll plan that for 6 o'clock. And if you get the opportunity to come out, these kids, you know, practice year round, or this whole year they've practiced the whole school year to do this concert, and they do some drama as well, and they do a really, really good job. So if you have the opportunity to get here, we'd appreciate that. And I'll have to check with them if we can possibly live stream it. Maybe we can do that too. But go ahead. Yeah, let's make it 6 o'clock, because I think we can get here by 6, and that way if people don't like driving after dark, which is always a concern, gives you a little more time. I don't think the concert would be more than an hour and a half long. So okay, of course, the conference is coming up in Milwaukee, if anybody's interested in going, July 29th to July 4th. We have a picnic planned with the Church of God Central PA at Pincho State Park. That'll be on Sunday, August 16th. That's always a good time, so hopefully you can make that. And of course, we have our Feast of Tabernacles celebration in the fall. We'll be having daily services. We have somewhat of a tentative schedule. We have our speakers lined up. And we probably need to have another meeting at some point and talk about more details of things we want to do. Can plan on that. Okay, any other announcements anybody has they'd like to mention? All right, then we will return. Dave Haver is our guest speaker today, but he called and said that he was running a little late. So hopefully he gets here in the next 15 minutes. If not, then we'll... What's that?
Put him on speakerphone.
Yeah. Well, originally Dave Noel was going to speak this week. Dave comes to me about once a year or so. He says, I got something I'd like to say. Or he's got a sermon in his mind. So I said, okay, well, next week then. And then I called him this week. I said, well, Dave, we're substituting you with the other Dave. And so he was good with that. But then I just told Dave a minute ago, I said, well, you maybe better be ready anyway. So hopefully Dave will show up. So, all right, well, let's begin with the worship.
Maybe the Lord wants us to hear two sermons today. Please stand as we continue with our worship. I'm going to read from Revelations 21, verse 3 through 4. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. We're now saying, oh, I want to see him, on page 418 in the worship and song.
Through
Amen. Good Sabbath. Amazing love. I honor you. So let us bow. Heavenly Father, your amazing love. Words cannot describe what you have done for me and for all that have accepted you. The grace, the love, the forgiveness of sin. Just thank you for that, Father. Father, as we come to this portion of our service to take up the offering, we thank you that you have blessed us to be able to give. But Father, keep our minds, our hearts, our thoughts on you, that not only should we give monetarily, but let us give of ourselves to build your kingdom till your coming, Father. And we thank you for this opportunity to give. We give you all. We thank you, we love you, and we ask these things in your precious Son who gave it all. In his name we pray. Amen.
Well, it's you got your mic on? Okay, it's on.
It's a blessing to have Dave return again. I know it's been a difficult time for him, as we know his dad passed away here maybe a month ago now.
Mm-hmm.
Last time he was here, right after Dave left, his dad passed away. So Dave's back in town to settle some affairs. But that's to our blessing to have Dave here to speak today. And he always asked if we have room on the program, and we always have room for Dave.
Thank you.
We're glad you're here, and so we thank you for coming, and we'll just pray and
Okay. Keep
preach. Almighty God, I thank you so much for your servant David, and our friend and our brother. And Lord, we just ask now that you would anoint him and bless him as he speaks today. We know that he will speak your words, and that we want to hear from you, and he's your vessel today to bring forth your words. So we thank you for that. We ask your blessing on him. Father, we pray that you would open our hearts and ears and minds to receive what you would have us to hear. And we thank you for that. And we just give you the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Yep.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm sorry I was running a little behind schedule. I suppose Bruce told you that I sent him left him a voice message saying, I'll make it, but I won't be here for the beginning. I'm glad I got here for some of the music, though, because that really helps the preacher as well. And I really appreciate the prayer you all do before the preacher starts going. But I also think it's great to hear the music. A lot of times in our building, there's a stage and I'm behind the curtain. And I just love to hear the beautiful music before you get started. It really sets the tone. So it's been quite a time of death, as Bruce mentioned. You know, it's been, like he said, there's been a month since I was up here visiting my father in his last days. Went home, and then when I got there, I got home, I think it was like on a Wednesday morning after midnight, about like 12:15, and about 5 o'clock in the morning then, my sister called. He had passed. I got to see him on his last day, and then came back for the funeral. And at the time, there were a lot of situations in our congregation going on. We had three people in hospice at that time. And as it turned out, I didn't want to be gone and miss any of that. I went to Arkansas to do a funeral of a friend. And then of those hospice people, one gentleman's gotten better. And so he's not great health, but he's out of hospice. One man died. And then this morning, the lady who was in hospice, she finally passed this morning. And that's why I was talking to the family, helping making funeral arrangements, and that's what got me delayed. So again, my apologies for not being here for the fellowship ahead of time, but I'm always glad to be with y'all and be here with you. You're a good congregation, you're a healthy congregation, and I consider you friends, and it's a privilege just to spend some time with you. If you look at the handout, the title of the sermon is called Understanding Boundaries. Understanding Boundaries. And I want to discuss the proven concept of boundaries and show how believers, why it's applicable to us. Because sometimes, this is from some of this information is from a book who's not a Church of God member, but he claims to be a Christian, claims to be a believer. And like you, I like to read a lot, and I like to compare everything I read back to the Bible. And I like to accept when people say truthful things, I like to accept it. If there are things they have that are not, which I don't consider to be truthful, I just try not to throw any stones. We try to learn from everybody. For the record, I've discussed this subject in Big Sandy on a number of occasions. I just mention that because sometimes people have listened in to our telecast or have gotten our DVDs and they've heard me talk about this subject. In fact, I'm giving the same subject over in the other group. And Sue Johns believes I've given this already. And I think it's because she's heard me say it somewhere else, but I've not given it over there. A question is, why am I discussing the subject here today? Well, I believe that the concept of boundaries is more important than many subjects you will ever hear in sermons, whether they're sermons on Saturday or whether they're sermons on Sunday. I believe the subject of boundaries is very, very important. I believe that some believers do not understand the subject of boundaries because they think that the word boundaries contradicts the Bible. I gave a presentation at a leadership at a Unity conference in Atlanta, Georgia, and I picked this subject to give. And here the whole conference was about unity in the Spirit, and I came in talking about boundaries. And your first impression would be, that doesn't seem to fit. How in the world can boundaries help bring unity? And I think you're going to see the way Henry Cloud describes it, and I think is supported by the Bible, definitely proves that and supports that. Let's quickly notice two reasons why people think the word boundaries contradicts the Bible. Some believers hear the word boundaries and conclude that the teacher is encouraging believers to be selfish. And you're going to see that there, in a boundary, there is some consideration for yourself. But I'll quickly give you, it's like if you're traveling on an airplane, and they talk, remember, some of you remember how they give that spiel, and one of the spiels is if all of a sudden we lose oxygen, there's going to be an oxygen mask come down, and what do they tell you to do? Make sure you take it for yourself first, and then help the person beside you. Because if you don't take care of yourself, you can't take care of other people. And that's so again, the concept of boundaries is not wanting people to be selfish, but it's really a better way to really help people to serve others. Some people hear the word boundaries and they conclude that the teacher is encouraging division or isolation. In other words, if they hear boundaries, it's like, okay, is that person saying we should be separate from everybody? Is that person saying we should be isolated from everybody? And that's why people jump to conclusions, and many churchgoers don't like the concept of boundaries. But if you read the book of Henry Cloud, he wrote the book back in 1992, and he's written many books since. And in fact, I think in my last sermon here a month ago, I quoted from one of his books. I think the book I quoted from was Never Go Back. I quoted from that because that's one of his recent books. Let's notice Matthew chapter 22, verse 39. The truth is, boundaries does not promote selfishness. In fact, personal boundaries should lead to mature love. I think if you just understand what is being said, what he teaches, and see how it's supported by the Bible, you'll see how it can help you. It can help your relationships. It can help your relationship with God starting out, but it can certainly help your relationships that you have in life. These principles can help your marriage. They can help your dealing with your children. It can help children coexisting together. I think these are very valuable principles. So notice this: boundaries does not promote selfishness, but notice we start with Matthew chapter 22, verse 39. The context, you know, is they're questioning Jesus. Different people are questioning Jesus to subvert him, to discredit him, to make him less popular in the eyes of the people of the community. And so finally they came to a man in verse 36 who said, "Master, what is the great commandment in the law?" And he gave a two-part answer. Verse 37, Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment." But he tags on something else in verse 39 and says, "The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And on these two great commandments hang all the law and the prophets." So all the beauty of the Old Testament Torah, all the beauty of the Old Testament prophets, all the beauty of the Old Testament writings that came to be magnified in the New Testament go on those two key commandments. The first one we're not going to spend a lot of time today is you love God with everything. He's number one. You give him all your attention, all your worship, all your respect, all your reverence goes to God. But the second one, think about this for a second. You'll love your neighbor as you love yourself. And I jokingly say to a lot of people, and it's not really, there's a lot of truth in what I'm saying, but I say it in a joking fashion, is I really hope you can love me better than you love yourself. I deserve better treatment than you give yourself. And while I'm saying it in a joking fashion to make a point, it's really true. You see, because some people are so hard on themselves, they're hard on you. And they're hard on me. And I don't deserve that. What did I do to that person to get that mistreatment? I realize, see, they're hard on themselves and they're just, you know, they treat others as they want to be treated. Like some people call a variation of that the golden rule. But the problem is, if you're hard on yourself, you're not going to be really good with other people. In fact, I oftentimes incorporate this concept into the wedding ceremonies I do. Because I incorporate this concept in there because if the couple's standing there looking at each other, and if one's really hard on themselves, they're either going to be hard on their wife or the wife's going to be hard on her husband because that's the way she's taught. And again, look, we've been taught this way. This is dealing with our background. This is dealing with our sometimes heredity, but oftentimes environment. And see, we have to learn to love ourselves. Now, because there are so many books written about self-love that do promote a little twisted view, sometimes we like to use the word self-respect, that we have to respect ourselves. And if you're more comfortable with the term self-respect, that's good. But I actually, quoting this, I think you'll love other people only as well as you love yourself. And I want to encourage you to love yourself, to respect yourself. That you need to understand that God gave his son for you. You know, we love God because he first loved us. He's saving us. He gives us all this grace and mercy. We're worth something to him. Of and by myself, I'm worth nothing of and by myself. I'm not special of and by myself. And I can say the same for you. But the fact is, God loves us all. And God looks at us and he just tremendously has given so much for us. The fact is he has the eternity for us. It's just amazing what he provides for us. Now let's look over in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3. Because we look here, we see that we're not to be being selfish and greedy. we're supposed to then look and see, as we have self-respect, from that foundation of self-respect, we come at verse 3, Philippians 2, verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. So we're not to be preoccupied with ourselves. We're not to be preoccupied with our needs or our lust or our desires or our whims. But from a foundation of self-respect, then we treat other people better. See, if you love yourself and you respect yourself, then you can really show people great love. It makes sense, doesn't it? Think about it again, your marriage. If you truly love your mate, then you'll be able to, you know, if you love yourself, then you'll be able to say good things for your mate. You'll be able to do wonderful things for your mate. So it's not trying to get us self-absorbed. It's accepting God's mercy, accepting God's grace, and passing it on to other people. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2. I'm going to encourage you to not allow people to guilt you into things. I'm going to encourage you not to allow people to manipulate you into things. I'm going to encourage you to be a cheerful giver. That's what it talks about here in 1 Peter 5, verse 2. He's talking to the elders. The elders among you, I exhort, I'm also an elder, verse 1. I'm a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and I'm a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly. Not for the money, but because you love doing it. And so the point is, I would encourage you to be a cheerful giver in everything you do. That is my goal, and I'm sure that's your goal as well. A lot of times I'll spend time with someone. Sometimes I'll spend 2 hours with someone. I'll give an example today. I was on the phone a lot today with people who are going through a trial. And you know what they said. They say things like, I'm sorry I'm taking up your time. And I tell them, I said, no, I'm the master of my own schedule. Do you not feel guilty about the time you're taking with me? I'm willingly giving this time to you. I'll still be able to make my commitment, what I need. They knew I had other commitments today. But I told them, I said, no. It's nice of you to want to apologize, but I willingly give my time. In everything I do, I try to willingly say yes, and I will willingly say no. And we have a congregation where people say no to me all the time. I wouldn't want it any other way. You strike me as a congregation where you can say no to your co-pastors. That's good. I know congregations where people feel guilty like they could never say no. I don't want that environment. In fact, I tell people I can't command anybody to do anything. So I kind of have to beg. And people say no to me, and I try to get different people to speak, and they say no. They'll usually say no, thank you. And I don't want them to do anything that they don't want to do. I want them to do it for the Lord. I want them to do it for their reputation and the service of other people. But we want to be cheerful givers, willing givers. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. See, one of the things I like to talk about from time to time is the subject of validation. Validation. In other words, what happens, why we do what we do. See, sometimes people give to make themselves feel worthy. And that's the wrong reason to give. In other words, they feel so badly about themselves. See, it goes back to that self-love again. They feel so badly about themselves, they think, you know, if I clean the church building, somehow I'll be more worthy. Cleaning the church building is nice. Running the sound system is nice. If I'm up here giving presentations for some wrong motivation deep down, even maybe things that you don't see, if I'm doing it for those reasons, God may say, yeah, I can still use you. Yes, you're still helping people. But just what is the reason why you're doing what you're doing? But because people are beaten down and Satan beats us down, so people think they have to do something for worthiness. Am I more worthy today because I spend a little time talking to you about some good things? That should not be my motivation, and I don't think it is, because I try to examine my motivation. All of us have to analyze what validates you. Why are you doing it? Are you doing it for praise? Are you doing it for acceptance? What is the reason? Of course, our goal should be to try to do it because we're trying to serve, and in our little way, we can help other people. But 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7, every man should give according as he purposes in his heart. Let him give, not grudgingly, not of necessity. God loves a cheerful giver. And that was mentioned in the prayer before the offering was made. Whatever money you put in the pot today should be willingly. Whatever you give of your time should be willingly. It's interesting, we don't talk, we're like you. You don't beat the drum for money, neither do we. In fact, one couple started attending our church. They'd been attending another Church of God. And they said, can we come? I said, sure, you can come anytime you want. And I just said, why do you want to come? And I won't say the name of the church, but they said, every week in their announcements, they're always talking about money. And I said, how often have you heard us talk about money? They said, you don't. You don't beg for money. No, we don't. I mean, again, sometimes people, I can certainly see why you would want to talk about funds, especially in meetings. Sometimes you may have certain talk about needs of missionary needs that you may want to do that. But even if you were to do those kind of things, which is appropriate, some churches are begging for money, and you just don't do that. Because we want people to be cheerful givers. I've been here. I've heard your pre-offering things. There's never any arm twisting going on. There shouldn't be. You just have an opportunity. See, that's one thing that I love about the Church of God Seventh Day, different than our branches of it, is we don't take up offerings every week. And in fact, I think it's a nice thing that happens. And there are probably some branches of the Church of God who would somehow think that's a bad thing. And to me, it would be like, show me in the Bible where that's a bad thing. I think that's a pretty good thing. So what's the difference between collecting it in church or having people send it in the mail? Because again, some of you probably give a little church and you send it in the mail. And some people give our church December 31st. They wait all year long and they do it right before the time to get it for their tax credit. We don't tell people how often. Again, there's no arm twisting. The point again is cheerful giving. Don't give grudgingly. And again, I know your church. I watch the different congregations I respect. We want to have control of our own life, cheerful giving, the right kind of giving. In your marriage, hopefully you're not doing things because you're feeling trapped or guilted or in bondage. That's the wrong motivation. Let's go to the next segment about the true concept of boundaries does not promote division or isolation. In fact, personal boundaries should lead to mature unity. Let's look at Ephesians 5. Ephesians 5, which you know it talks about, if you remember, talks about marriages. Responsibilities for husbands, responsibilities for wives. Picturing the church, picturing the mystery of the church. Ephesians 5, verse 28. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loves his wife loves himself. So again, the husband there, he's trying to look out for her needs. He's trying to look out for her desires. Verse 29, no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, even as the Lord does the church. So again, Paul's saying, you love yourself. You bathe yourself. You educate yourself. You take care of yourself. When you enter into a marriage, you want to pass that love on to your one flesh partner. Again, a husband who hates himself is not going to do a good job of loving his wife. A husband who doesn't feel it's important to educate himself is not going to feel good about seeing his wife get education. A husband who doesn't, whatever it is, and same for the wife. Although this is talking, the husband loves the wife. If he's going to be a leader, he wants to be sure to do that. But the wife is a teammate. They're together, one flesh. And it works the same way. If a wife doesn't love herself, there's just nothing going to happen. So if you have self-respect, that's the way to get together. If you have self-respect in this congregation, you're going to get along better with the congregation and help this congregation to be stronger spiritually. And then we're a sister congregation to you. See, we support your sovereignty, by the way. I don't and ever want to come in here trying to undo everything, whatever you do as a sovereign congregation. But likewise, you don't threaten our sovereignty. And so thereby, we can be sovereign congregations. You have self-respect. We have self-respect. And we can find ways to work together. Now, you have your primary is with the Church of God Seventh Day, and you get involved with all the connections you have. But again, you work as a congregation, strong, independent, strong, cooperating willingly with other congregations. And the thing is, if you all said to me, Dave, we've really enjoyed you speaking here, but no thanks for in the future, we're done with you, you would have the right to say that. You would have that right to say that, and what could I say? I'd be disappointed and be like, well, what I would say is, what did I do? Oh no, what did I do? Please tell me what I did so I can learn from it. But the point is, you have the when I tell Bruce or Bob that I'm coming in the area, that's you have the right to say who the speakers are. If you say, no, we'd really rather not, then that's your right to do that. I support that right. I want you to notice Galatians 2. I think it's great when congregations cooperate in a bigger network, because when you cooperate in a bigger network, you get to do bigger things, don't you? Things that you can't do just by yourselves. But I want you to remember this. I believe in personal sovereignty with you as a person, personal sovereignty with you as a couple, as a family, and personal sovereignty as you as a congregation. Choosing willingly to participate, not because of guilt, not because of pressure, but you choose to do so. I've mentioned this to some of the controlling churches. You don't participate in a controlling church. Oh, I suppose occasionally we can all see controlling elements, but I want you to notice something. I love it here, Galatians 2, verse 6. Paul is saying that he went to some people who seemed to be somewhat. Parentheses. Whatever they were, it makes no difference to me. Now, was he respectful to other people? Yes, because he was a respectful man. But was he respectful to people who were rude? Was he respectful to he'd be kind and civil, but would he knuckle under to the false apostles he talked about or the false prophets he talked about? I love the Galatians 15. Let me digress here. Galatians 15, remember that was the circumcision chapter. Remember? They came together to decide what were they going to do with circumcision. Sometimes people think, well, if you get a group together, if you get a chosen group together, whatever they say is from God and we have to do whatever they say. I don't believe that. What I believe is a group can decide if it's a group that people are looking to as a leader, they can look to that person and say, we value your opinion, we value what you're saying. But if a pastor, in my church start preaching things that are not biblical, those people should not follow me. If a group of people are doing things that are not right, you shouldn't follow them. The point is, when Paul in Acts 15, when they decided that circumcision was not required, what would have happened, do you think, if those people got together and said, well, our decree is you're all going to have to be circumcised? Do you for a minute think Paul would have said, okay, that's what the group said, that's what I'm going to do? I don't think that for a minute. I think Paul would have had to reevaluate his association with them because he was convicted by God that circumcision was not required. Now, he might have said, okay, you all can do that if you want, but I have to follow God, and so thereby, I can't do that. See, some people think you have to follow whatever the majority says. No, I think we need to be respectful and participatory and helping. But if Paul here said, again, verse 6, I went to those who seemed to be somewhat. Whoever they were doesn't matter to me because God accepts no man's person. For those who seemed to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. I went to the leaders. I went to the people thought were leaders. And the good news was we agreed. And that was good. But I think Paul would have said, I went to them. We didn't agree. I can't work with them. I'm not going to make trouble for them. I just can't work with them. But contrary wise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed to me, just as the gospel of the circumcision was given to Peter, for he that wrought effectively in Peter the apostleship to the circumcision, the same was mighty to me toward the Gentiles. Paul was saying, I saw what God was doing through me. I'm glad they saw what God was doing through me. I saw what God was doing through Peter. They saw what God was doing through me. We can harmonize together, work together. Good communication, humble communication, finding agreement in the Holy Spirit, finding agreement in the lead of God in Christ. But the point is, again, boundaries do not divide people. They actually make for what I consider mature unity. Because when a married couple, see, a married couple who's trapped, who hate each other, but stay together, that's not unity. But two strong people, independent strong people, who come together and make a commitment through the God, the love of God, the Holy Spirit, that's where you have a strong marriage. When you have congregations who are strong, who come together, the husband doesn't rule the wife oppressively, the wife doesn't rule the husband oppressively, two strong people making agreements, coming together, that's when you have a strong marriage. And the same is about congregations. So the point is, verse 9, so when James, Peter, and John, who seemed to be the pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave to me and Barnabas their right hands of fellowship. And in a sense, what you do as a congregation, by the way, you do that very nicely. When I come up, when any of our guest speakers come up here, I don't know if you do that for every week for all your speakers, but when a guest speaker comes up, you basically give me the right hand of fellowship. And you also pray that I do a good job in case I'm about ready to screw up. You try to help yourselves out a little bit. Pretty smart. But that's basically what you did up here. You give me the right hand of fellowship. You pray for me personally. You pray for me helping you. And the right hand of fellowship is a strong thing. And again, people working ways to work together. Again, I can't control you. I don't try to control you. You know what would happen if I tried to control you? You wouldn't have me speak anymore. And if you came down to our place and tried to control us, we wouldn't have you speak. We like humble servants. We have a lot of guest speakers. See, I still travel twice a month. So when I travel, I have to make sure I have good speaking back home. Because if I don't have good speaking back home, I hear about it. And then they say you can't travel as much. And, I talk about this. I'm not responsible for everything the men say when I'm gone. But I am responsible for the invitation. I'm the one who invited them. In baseball, if you come up to bat 10 times and have 4 hits, you're in the Hall of Fame. If you bat 400, was Ted Williams the last one to bat 400? If you bat 400, you're in the Hall of Fame. You know what my batting average has to be back home? 1,000. In 18 years, I've had one speaker that was a disaster. And then also I had situations where I had one speaker that didn't work out so well, but it was not a disaster. So the good news is I have to bat for the invitation. I really have to have good batting average. Okay, let me just spend a little time talking about some of Henry Cloud's comments. There's 3 problems among all people, including believers. Number one, people try to establish boundaries for others. They try to control other people. We should not be trying to control each other. Number two, people allow other people to establish boundaries for them. They allow other people to control them. And number three, people don't establish boundaries for themselves. They do not control their own actions. So again, summarizing then, we should not try to control other people. We should not let people control us. But we do need to try to establish boundaries for our behavior and try to take accountability. It says here, I'm going to just mention briefly here, In 1992, Dr. Henry Cloud and Dr. John Townsend wrote a popular book titled Boundaries. Part of the purpose of the book is listed this: when to say yes and how to say no, to take control of your own life. And I wrote down the chapters of the book to show that what the book talks about. What does a boundary look like? On pages 35 through 40, under the subhead Examples of Boundaries, the authors listed the following 8 characteristics. Do you know what the first boundary is? Skin. Think about that a second. If you've ever done professional counseling, or if you've ever done some pastoral counseling, if you tried to help with situations, sometimes, unfortunately, people get sexually abused. And see, they prey on little children who don't realize the skin is a boundary. Who touches you? You have the power over who touches you. And little children don't know that. And that's why cowards who do horrible things prey on children. The most basic boundary that defines you is your physical skin. Victims of physical and sexual abuse often have a poor sense of boundaries. Early in life, they were taught that their property did not really begin at their skin. And so that's something, you know, that's the number one thing is your skin. But remember this, please remember this. You determine who touches you. Please remember that phrase, you determine who touches you. Again, some people say, well, I know a lot of people who push past that boundary. Friends and brethren, you determine who touches you. Even in a relationship of marriage, when the Bible does say that the husband's wife, the husband's body belongs to the wife's body belongs to the husband, well, there's truth in that they one flesh share that. But even there in marriage, husbands and wives should not be forcing themselves on each other. They need to find out proper ways of communication of how to share each other's bodies. You determine who touches you. Then it talks about words. The most basic boundary setting word is no. It lets others know that you exist apart from them and that you are in control, and that you are in control of you. So again, the word no is a very important word. Another boundary is truth. There's always safety in the truth, whether it be knowing God's truth or knowing the truth about yourself. Another boundary is geographical distance. And there comes a time when you need distance from someone physically. Can you think of a biblical example needed that? Paul and Barnabas. They needed distance from each other. They still loved each other. In fact, they became reconciled at some point, but they needed distance. Another boundary is time. Another boundary is emotional distance. Sometimes you just need a break from somebody. You need away from them emotionally. Emotional distance is a temporary boundary to give you your heart the space it needs to be safe. It is never a permanent way of living. And of course, other people and consequences are that. Now let's hear on the next segment, on pages 40 to 50, the authors listed the following 10 items that are within your boundaries. Your feelings. Feelings have gotten a bad rap in the Christian world. They have been called everything from unimportant to fleshly. Feelings should neither be ignored nor placed in charge. The Bible says to own your feelings and be aware of them. They can often motivate you to do much good. The Good Samaritan's pity moved him to go to the injured Israelite in Luke 10. The father of the prodigal son was filled with compassion for his lost son and threw his arms around him. Many times Jesus had compassion for the people to whom he ministered. Feelings come from your heart and can tell you the state of your relationships. Your feelings are your responsibility and you must own them and see them as your problem as you begin to find an answer to whatever is the problem. Again, you don't want your feelings to rule you, but you don't want to ignore your feelings as well. It talks about attitudes and beliefs. Attitudes have to do with your orientation towards something, the stance you take toward others, God, life, work, and relationships. Beliefs are anything that you accept as true. People with boundary problems usually have distorted attitudes about responsibility. It talks about behaviors and choices. You know, you need to take responsibility for your choices. Setting boundaries inevitably involves taking responsibilities for your choices. You are the one who makes them. That way we don't get into the blame game of blaming other people. Yes, we can recognize when other people are going against our boundaries, but what are we going to do about it? Are we going to be victims? Or are we going to say, you know, that person's trying to hurt me? What would Jesus do? What would Paul do? What would David do? What choices would they make? Values, what we value is what we love and assign importance to. Often we do not take responsibility for what we value. Limits. In reality, setting limits on others is a misnomer. We can't do that. What we can do is set limits on our own exposure to people who are behaving poorly. We can't change them or make them behave right. We need to be able to say no to ourselves. Talents. Our talents are clearly within our boundaries and our responsibility, yet taking ownership of them is often frightening and always risky. We should take ownership of our thoughts, our desires, and concerning love, many people have difficulty giving and receiving love because of hurt and fear. Having closed their hearts to others, they feel empty and meaningless. The Bible is clear that both functions of the heart, the receiving of grace and love inward and the flow outward. Now, for the record, he wrote a book in 2010. Dr. Henry Cloud wrote a book titled Necessary Endings. Excuse me. The purpose of the book is listed as the employees, businesses, and relationships that all of us have to give up in order to move forward. I just gave a copy of, I gave a book to a lady who I know from a different country. I saw her recently, and she's getting a divorce. And it's really a horrible time for her. You know, the Bible wants all of us to stay together in marriage. Oftentimes, I'd like to use the phrase, we preach the rule, but we counsel the exception. And so your pastors will preach the rule, and we counsel the exception. And there is a time for divorce, and the Bible outlines some of the details on that. But we're not hoping that 90% of the marriages get divorced. But occasionally it happens. It happens even among the Church of God. And it should be done for biblical reasons. But when people get divorces, it's very tough because they feel guilty. And sometimes other people will try to make them feel guilty. Sometimes it's what's called a necessary ending, whether it be a business or whether it be a family situation or relationship. Sometimes it's a necessary ending. It should not be entered into selfishly. That should not be done capriciously. Usually most people try to make things work, whatever the situation is. But sometimes there is a necessary ending. And then 2011, Dr. John Townsend wrote the book Beyond Boundaries, and he talks about moving past boundaries. But it all started with this book in 1992, and more importantly, when you read any of Clouds or Townsend's material, whatever you read about that, always take it back to the Bible. I just want to leave you back with Matthew chapter 22 again. Whatever you read from anybody, please always compare it back to the Bible. Because when you read different things, you will find many times they have got good information, sometimes a lot of good information. And take personal responsibility for what you read. Compare it back to the Bible, and then try to use the good material. My thought is this. If Henry Cloud and John Townsend can understand these things, how about you? You have God's Spirit, and I think you can understand them. You can take what they've learned, what they based it on their view of the Bible. You can take what they've learned, and you can look at your view of the Bible, and you can also become experts of this. To me, the more people are experts of understanding boundaries, it will help your life, but it will help the life of other people you come in contact with. We started back in Matthew chapter 22, and I want to conclude with that. Matthew 22, verses 36 through 40. Master, what is the great commandment in the law? Jesus says, you'll love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like it. It says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and all the prophets. Brethren, I hope that your relationship with God goes stronger than ever. I hope your relationship with other people goes stronger than ever. I believe that the more you understand boundaries, with the backing of the Bible, you'll have better relationship with God, but mostly better relationship with each other. And that's why I wanted to spend a little time with you today, because I wanted to help influence you, to help you understand boundaries.
Thank you, Mr. Haver. If you would please stand and turn to page 157, we'll sing The Love of God.
Thank you.